I said, Mom, I want you to know something. I'm really happy out here and I'm doing what I want to do. And if I don't make it, and if I do die out here, I just want you to know that I died happy.
It completely caught me off guard, like completely. And I didn't believe it when I heard it. And I still like don't, but it's crazy.
Trader in Chicago, right? Trading in the soybean meal pit. I turned myself into a thousandaire. I made thousands of dollars, right? And I saved it and I asked myself, well, now that I have this money, you know, what do I really want to do? Because I didn't need like all the things that I saw that everybody else needed, $500 pairs of shoes. The other traders were spending around me like expensive steak dinners. Like, I didn't need any of that, you know? You know, I just asked myself that simple question when I'd made this certain amount of money, is like, what is it that I really want more than anything else? What do I want out of life?
In Chicago, when he was trading, he had a one-man rowboat on Lake Michigan. Wooden, little white-painted wooden row. I mean, this thing couldn't have been more than 5 feet long. And he would just take this thing out and huge swells would come up and people would be, you know, yelling at him, you know, you need to go back to shore, this is dangerous, what are you doing, you're insane. And Captain Alex just, it was already there in him. He was just going along, loving it. And he just kept going back to it and just, so that's what got him going.
When he was a trader making as much money as a person could make, he was living in his van because he wanted to save as much money as possible. So he lived in a van and got up, went outside to go to work. I think he parked around the corner. And that's a quick way to save up your money.
They got to the point where, you know, I was making all this money and I just wasn't happy anymore. And then like the trading started to change a little bit. And I came in one night and I think I was drunk and, you know, I lost a bunch of money and it was like, what the heck am I doing here? You know, I'm like, I'm not enjoying my life trading, you know. As much as I did enjoy it, like I knew there was something else missing.
My sister goes, Vanessa, there's this dude, you guys are the exact same. He likes to travel, he's crazy. And she's like, you have to meet him. He's like, hey, I'm Alex Ross, my sister's setting me up with you. And I was like, all right, sweet. I gave him a high five and then we went bowling that night. The board of trade where he was working for, they set up a bunk bed in his office because he didn't have anywhere to live. So we went back there at like midnight. And then we ended up sleeping in that bed and we were thinking we were gonna get up at like 6 in the morning. And we woke up to a whole bunch of businessmen and everybody like all working in their business suits professionally. And me and him are in the middle of the floor in this bunk bed, like at the Board of Trade on the middle of the floor in a bunk bed.
Vanessa ended up moving into the van with me. And I was like, shit, where you been all my life? You know, we were just really perfect together. But I'd already made this decision to do this boat trip.
I quit my job and I decided, okay, you know, I just basically Googled on the internet, like, where are the most sailboats? It kept coming up, Fort Lauderdale, Florida. So I went down to Fort Lauderdale and started looking for a boat.
I was like, shit, this would be a lot more fun with somebody else, you know? And so I called Vanessa up and I invited her to come down. And she was only supposed to stay for a week and then ended up being about 6 months.
That's when we bought the wild sea monkey. It was a 27-foot 1977 Hunter. It was a very, very, very small boat.
It was cheap, paid $3,000 for it, bought it on Craigslist, thought for sure I was gonna sink it.
We lived in a harbor in Fort Lauderdale because the boat was basically a third underwater. We spent 30 days fixing that beast up.
This is where we've been sleeping for the past
did not have a toilet, did not have a shower. It didn't have anything.
And then, here's some of the food that we got to show them, all the food we got stored for you guys.
We just talked to a bunch of people who were boat owners, and everybody was saying how we had to take a course before we started sailing, and he was definitely against that.
I flew down there a couple times and helped him, you know, set stuff up on it and just tinker with it, and he had never really drove it out in the water or anything before when we went out the first day. And they told us not to go out because the waves are too big. It was a disaster. All the ropes off the side of the boat were flying into the water and getting wrapped around the prop, and the boat stopped, and we're just bouncing around. We got one buddy, he's throwing up everywhere. Alex has got a book called Sailing for Dummies, and he was dead serious. He told me to go down below and read on how we're supposed to turn the boat.
Thing is, I should have read it earlier on, because we get the jib sheet caught in the prop, and I'm reading the book later. I'm like, oh man, it says you're supposed to do this with the jib sheet, the stopper knot. And then you don't get it caught in the prop. And I'm like, oh, that's great.
He gave me a call one day, and he's like, hey, Gerber, I need you to come down to Florida, and we're gonna go sail. Like, someone needs to teach me. And I was like, I barely know how to sail, man. Like, I've sailed with my dad a little bit, but I haven't sailed that much. He had told me he took a captain's course, and it turns out he took like a celestial navigation, like booze cruise, which had nothing to do with, he had no idea how to sail.
We've done practice sails in Fort Lauderdale, and we ran aground about 9 times before we actually decided to leave that harbor. And then after we ran aground about 9 times, he was like, that's enough practice, we're just gonna go for it.
So, this is, day 0 right now. We're getting ready to leave and having some engine problems. Rust is down there, trying to see if we got a problem with our prop. Seems to be having a panic attack. How's it going down there, Rust? Yeah, he's having a panic attack, so.
Looks like it's gonna be a good one, so hopefully I don't die. Talk to you again.
We left on December 30th, 2008. And this was our first sail ever. We thought it was gonna take maybe 4 or 5 hours. That's the normal time to get to Bimini.
We just went through a little bit of a squall. We passed the sail, but I can barely see
it. It ended up taking us about 12. We had emergency nothing. We didn't even have maps. If anything were to go wrong, we were done. We ended up pulling into Bimini early on December 31st, and we were all really, really excited because we actually made it.
It was the 3 of us, and there was a V berth. They were sleeping up there. There was another bed, like another berth that I kind of slept underneath where you'd sit when you were sailing. And we were hanging out, bouncing around the island. The Bahamas and Bimini, they're beautiful islands. We had an awesome time and gave all of us a good taste of what cruising life is like. I had planned to go back to work. There was no plan for me to sail any longer, and I had a flight paid for out of the Bahamas for me to fly back. They had all the intentions of continuing to sail.
At this point, our distances got a little bit longer. We were going 2 or 3 days in between islands instead of about 7 or 8 hours.
Yeah, this is gonna be exciting. I can't wait to see the fish.
Pick it up, man.
Going crazy.
Shit, we gotta hit him in the head.
No.
Turks and Caicos, Dominican Republic, DR, Puerto Rico, Puerto Rico, USVIs, then we go to the BVIs, then we go to St. Martin, then we go to St. Eustatius, St. Kitts, Nevis, St. Lucia, St. Vincent, Grenada, Trinidad, Tobago, Venezuela.
I actually thought that I knew that I was gonna sink that boat, but I didn't. I ended up making it all the way through the Caribbean.
Las Roques, Aves, Bonaire, and then Curacao.
That whole year of experimenting through the Bahamas, once he realized he made it, which a lot of people had doubts, I knew he was looking bigger and beyond. And for me, it's time to move on at that point.
Vanessa on the first trip, me and Vanessa got along so well, but she just, it wasn't quite.
I took a flight home to Chicago shortly after that.
And I sold the boat in Curacao. At this point, I've been all in the Caribbean. I've been all these islands, and I was like, well, this is great, you know, but man, I'm ready to cross an ocean.
When your dad buy this land?
Oh, I'm not even for sure. I mean, this is where we grew up. I don't know the exact time we bought it, but a while back. Yeah, the place we were at before.
Alex, he liked to do crazy things. We had a six-wheeler, like a gator, and he would go and egg people, knock their mailbox over with a hammer. One time, like, I went with him, and I kind of wish I hadn't, but I just remember, like, riding past the neighbors, and they, like, had their gun out the window, like, yelling at us to go home.
I have eight brothers and four sisters. Dad had 13 of us kids. It was always a lot of fun with that many people.
Hello. Hi.
I love being out in the country, and I like being away from it all, you know.
When I was 12, I lived in Brazil for a year. I was a bit of a misbehaved child, so my dad sent me down there. And just seeing that planted a seed inside me.
I'm getting fucking emotional.
What's wrong, bud?
Nothing.
So where are we?
Oh, yeah. This is back home, southern Indiana, where I grew up. We used to spend our summers here playing in the water. This is first experience with water. So out here, Dad would take us out on a little rowboat. We'd do a little fishing.
Our dad was born, lived with a permanent address, and died all within a 3-mile radius. But he traveled the globe. He went all sides of the world. That carried on with us kids, and specifically with Alex.
He died in 2003 while I was at Purdue. And, but I still made it through that semester, still got good grades and everything, and stayed up with everything, still got a good job after school and all these different things.
He showed it to be okay. It's hard to say. He don't show feelings very much, so it's hard to say how he really was, but.
But I think, you know, I never really maybe dealt with the fact that he was gone now. I was like, I want to do a big trip when I graduate from Purdue. So I get three other friends together, and we decide we're going to hitchhike across Africa, Cape Town to Cairo. There, I was kind of opened up to a lifestyle that was just free and open and simple, just so different. And it was a phenomenal trip. The African continent kind of put something in my mind like, wow, there's this whole other world out there.
It seems like he does something and then needs to think of the next big thing that's bigger. And so every time he does something, we're like, oh, well, that was probably like the biggest thing you could imagine. And then he came up with going around the world on a boat.
And the more I thought about it, it was like, yes, no, that's exactly what I want to do. I want to sail around the world.
We didn't know if this trip, because the way he talked about it too, he's like, I might not come back, you know? And so of course, like for my mom, that was really hard.
There we go.
Get older and play.
Boy, I don't know about
this.
Okay. Look at here.
I was ready. I felt like very confident that I was ready to cross an ocean. I knew what I wanted and needed, an ocean crossing boat. What I really wanted, I wanted a pirate ship, right? I wanted a wooden wheel with spokes. I wanted a crow's nest and a plank. Those are like my three requirements that I wanted in a boat. But then after sailing in the Caribbean, I realized that, well, you know, maybe I need to focus more on like rigging and you know anchors and things that make more sense. What I found was so many boats for sale in the States aren't boats ready to cross oceans. They're ready for people to live on. They just live on these boats. They got carpet and microwaves in them instead of having anchors and sails. Like, they're just liveaboards. And I wanted a boat that was ready to sail across an ocean, you know? So then I had some buddies I was in contact with that helped me find Bubbles in Tortola. Let's see, I paid about $70,000 for Bubbles, 39-foot monohull, cutter rig sloop.
I don't know how he necessarily came up with the name Bubbles. It sounds like a stripper's name of some sort or some like children's book. It was a fun name and it was perfect for the boat.
It was uncomfortable, it was dirty. Had a lot of cockroaches and bugs, and like I said, when I got there, he had no refrigerator. Hot as can be, stunk, just nasty.
Once I made that decision in the beginning to sail around the world, there was never an option of stopping, turning around, quitting where I was. The only thing that would have stopped me was death. Like, nothing else would have stopped me from this mission, nothing. When I set sail for the first time, from St. Thomas in the U.S. Virgin Islands alone, I realized fairly quickly how boring or an unenjoyable trip it would be sailing around the world by myself.
Beautiful sunrise this morning. Now we got some dolphins swimming with us.
There was like this big, beautiful rainbow comes out and there's a, you know, bunch of dolphins swimming at the bow. And I remember just like, turning from, you know, left to right and almost being like, oh my gosh, do you see that? You just want to share it with somebody. I just wanted to be like, wow, you know, this is cool, but I didn't have anybody else there. So there was no one to like kind of share the excitement with. And that was one of the reasons why I started picking people up and to share the experience with other people along the way.
Alex has always been an adventurer. He's traveled, I mean, his passport stamps probably outnumbered 50 before this trip even started. So he's the guy that initially got me into world travel. I mean, these off-the-wall experiences, whether backpacking around Colombia in a Mitsubishi truck for 5 days with 8 guys packed in the back or heading down to Honduras. I mean, Russ opened my eyes to this world. And then all of a sudden, he's telling me he's sailing around the world. So I'm like, wow, what an opportunity for me to like, you know, really take advantage of my buddy and jump on his boat in these off-the-wall places that I'll never be able to get to in my life.
Dude, I have no idea what the fuck's going on right now. Kind of sick, but I'm gonna try to fight it here, get my shit together, and enjoy this.
I knew it was gonna be a blast. I knew it was gonna be a blast. You know, you get in with the locals and you do stuff that I never would have probably, I wouldn't have done much of it on my own. He's just a friendly person. There's always fun stuff going on around him. He's always in a good mood. We got along good for, you know, for that reason. And it was going to be an adventure.
There was certain kind of freshness to it, definitely. I mean, I hadn't been sailing before, so this was the first trip. Didn't know really what to expect. Different levels of sailing always, but yeah, the trust was there because we were open and we were all first timers.
Yeah, there's Panu. Say hi, Panu.
Yeah, what's up, guys? We were ready for adventure. It looked like a wolf pack, like three musketeers ride on. And it's probably like with all great adventures. The fears are very real because it's the unknown.
That's the really cool part about Bubbles is that everyone does their own part, whether that's cleaning dishes or even taking a night shift and sailing the boat. So even if you've never sailed before, Alex is gonna put you behind the wheel and go to sleep and say, keep us heading in this direction, yeah. Keep this bearing, and if anything bad goes wrong, wake me up.
Ah, this stuff.
Something's falling.
Everyone knew Alex in a different way. So they'd all shared some portion of the trip with him. It's almost like, you know, he's like a brother figure for a lot of people, or like even, I mean, it sounds silly, but a father figure, maybe.
Diego Eduardo Iglesias Maruri.
And where are you from?
I'm from the Galapagos Islands in the Pacific. I'm 21 years old. I didn't know anything about sailing or boats. But then I saw Bubbles, and that was the only boat with a big like plantain like full of bananas, you know? And I'm like, wow, that's like real sailors, you know? These guys might be like super good sailors. I don't know how true it was with that, but.
Hey, you're being a real big help too.
I had no idea where we were going, man. I thought we were going to Indonesia, but we were going to French Polynesia. So I told my mom, yeah, mom, I met these guys, they're super good sailors. And she was like, okay, where are you going? I think I'm going to Indonesia. It's only going to take a month, mom, you know? So fun, man.
It's been quite a navigational path we've taken. Take a look.
We sailed a lot. A lot of it was going the distance. You just float for like a week, and then you end up, you hit another island. You're like, oh, these people look cool. All right, let's party.
There were people I knew that joined the boat, and there were people I had no idea who they were. There had to be something like 80 different people that jumped on the boat.
With the Dutch Waffle, Sheila the She-Wolf, Ross Gerber the Gerb, Izzy the Israeli, Jesse the Body, and Dougie Fresh.
Kirk, Jimmy, and Nicola on board.
That's counting islanders who would hop from one island to another, people he found on Facebook, people he found on cruise sites, just random people. They're also great friends that were growing up.
Video camera. Make a movie. With you. With Beetlenut.
Alex, he had some sort of aspiration to make some sort of film based upon his trip. He was meeting all these awesome people and seeing these things that no one gets to see. I think that he wanted to show people that. He always had like these shitty little point-and-shoot cameras that were supposedly like indestructible. And he'd open his captain's drawer and there'd be like seven cameras in there just smashed to all hell. Anytime you came on the boat, you had to get one of these Canon power shots or whatever they were called, some indestructible camera that was waterproof to 30 or 60 feet. And he ripped through those things like, you know, they were disposables. He had tons of them laying around. Whenever anything like kind of neat would happen, he'd jump up and grab the camera. If it was like a fun party or just something wild, he seemed to always be wanting to tape it.
This guy's good.
Look at that. That's awesome.
He had given up everything. He was all in. He had a boat and he really had nothing else to go back to. He never flew back to the States once he started.
We on Tuppus here at Control Tower. Check these views out. We're up pretty high. It's a long way down, baby. It's a long way down, but we're all right.
Sailing is the absolute epitome of travel. There is not a better way to travel. It's so peaceful and serene. The other side is you get cut and you get nicked because it's rough. You get bumps and bruises and cuts and they will not heal. Just the tiniest little thing that wouldn't bother you on land takes months to heal and is always open and is always raw. And there's salt just penetrates everything. Your clothes are salty. You feel crusty. And there's part of you that always misses the land and everything that comes with the land. There's definitely a sense of security of being on the ground.
The difference between what we did on Bubbles and what most people do is they'll leave from one port, they'll sail around the world, be at sea the entire time and come back. That is, I see no gain in that. I mean, I wanted to explore the world, I wanted to see places, I wanted to meet people. And so the pace that we set with that ended up being based a lot on, I wanted to see other forms of life that were living in the world. Humans, animals, everything. I want to see different places, what was out there. That's like exactly what I wanted to go see. I really wanted to go explore.
Holy smokers.
We did a route around the world going from hemisphere to hemisphere where the storm seasons weren't.
You actually see the colors and the formations of all these little tiny rocks.
And so you're always in summer, basically, right? You're always in a good time of year.
It's just a cool place.
Just coming into this cave right here. Big one, Joe! Oh, oh my God! Oh shit, this is gonna be wet!
To tell everybody what's going on here?
Water spout, over there.
Oh yeah, water. Appears to be a water tornado coming our way.
He's a big risk taker. I always told him, limit your risk, because every day you're on that same risk. So if you are taking a risk, whatever's gonna go wrong will happen at some point if you keep taking that risk over and over again. Some of the time you're kind of like, really?
Yeah, we got it.
I knew that the sailing was gonna get harder and I knew that the weather was gonna get crazier. If you get bad weather, there's just a lot more to hit. I was worried he was gonna make some bad decisions around that. We almost hit a reef in one of the atolls.
So we'd like to go to that island to meet our friend, but there is the reef line just in front of us and it's too shallow for us to go.
Part of this lagoon wasn't mapped out. We didn't have charts for it. And Alex is like, we're going straight across because we're in a hurry.
What do you see, Ben?
I can see it's really shallow on the sides. There might be a passage in the middle.
You're like threading the needle going through all these reef spots because it's like there's head here and he's up there saying, oh, it's right here, come on. He's pointing down and you're like, oh yeah, there it is.
It's gonna be coming right off our, we're gonna be in a port tack when we come out. We're gonna have to sheet it in. It's probably gonna be on our...
Why do we wanna try and cut this corner if one of us slips up?
Yeah, nice.
If we're gonna hit it, we're gonna hit it. The captain said we're sailing. There's nothing we can do. And I thought I saw different colored water. Brady was running up one side of the boat and you could tell we were going into coral. Like we're going full bore into coral right now. And so I yelled, turn port, and Brady yelled, turn starboard. And if we would have turned port, we would have sunk. Russ, like, threw the wheel. We did a U-turn out of it. It was just a miracle we didn't hit anything. Like, it was absolutely a miracle. So then we sailed into safer water. But I yelled at him, I'm like, dude, what the, why was that worth it? And he's like, I'm in a hurry to get around the world. I don't got time to wait. Everyone's fine. I was like, you could have killed one of us, man, to save 2 hours.
It's his boat. I like how he challenged me and I challenge him. It's a good dynamic. If anything happens, we sink this boat. That was the coolest thing that we ever did in life. We fucking sank a boat in the middle of the ocean. Like, if worse came to worse, you lose a boat with your shit on it. Like, so what?
Me and Diego, I know there was parts of us that were slightly worried, you know? That something might go wrong and that we may be locked out a few times.
Oh, we had a lot of hairy moments. Diego got upset with me a couple times. The way that I ran the boat, there was a couple hairy situations that put us in.
It's like nighttime. I was up in the bow. Of course, no clips, no life jackets, anything. All the life jackets were thrown away, like, 2 years before that. It was super, super dark, man. All I could see was just like nothing. The whisker pull attached to the sheet, it started like going nuts, man. The sail was like all the way out, flapping nonstop, crazy. And then I just felt like someone took a bat and just like slapped me in the shoulder, man, so hard. Pretty much like just bring me all the way back.
The baby stay was in between him and the pole, and luckily it was there, and it just hit him in the chest. But if it would have hit him in the head, even with that stay there, or if the stay wouldn't have been there, I mean, it could have easily killed him. He just came back to the cockpit, and he just kind of like sat down, and he was just like he would have died there if it would have been a few inches the other way.
I just sat, man. I was like, that was just like so stupid.
And he was very upset with me that had happened.
It was not a good situation over there. After that one, we realized, you know, just how fast thing shit happens, you know.
I thought he was gonna die, for sure. I thought for sure. This is a dude who is living life to the fullest, and he's probably gonna make a decision that, like, his luck runs out on, you know? And I guarantee I couldn't have been the first person that said this. Like, we love Alex Russ, but this is his life, man. That's fate, that's destiny for him, you know?
Dead behind us right now. We're sailing wing on wing. Got the jib pulled out. Life's good.
get you a hat that says Barack Obama.
Papua New Guinea is one of the last wild frontiers in the world.
Coming into mainland Papua New Guinea, here.
This is like the last great world that you can go explore where like people are still very tribal. This is where the cannibals used to reign, you know, up until just the 1970s. The security guards there still use bow and arrow. Because, like, yeah, it's awesome.
Right there, our first island in PNG. It's not really an atoll, like an actual island of PNG. This is kids. They're just everywhere.
Rejoins us in Madang, Papua New Guinea. So I get to the airport, get off the plane. Of course, Alex is sitting there instantly with a cooler full of beers. And a whole Papua New Guinean family, like, waiting for my arrival. I come out, he's only been there a week, and he already has his family that he's calling mom and dad.
And girlfriend.
And yeah, girlfriend. Yeah. Within 5 minutes of being there, I'm on the parents' truck. We're driving around. We hop in the sailboat. We got, like, 30 little kids in the boat sailing around the harbor. I mean, it's like he's been there for months, but he's only been there for 5 days. Everybody's giving him hugs. Just how easily he can get into some new area and people just fall in love with him and want to be around him.
That's a volcano over there in the distance. There's a volcano right there. There's another volcano.
I was like, well, you know, we'd like to hike the volcano. We'd like to get a closer look at it. So we take the dinghy around the volcano. We pull up to this place, this meeting spot. And this is just the middle of the jungle, and it's like a rock. There's no dock. There's nothing like, there's no infrastructure there. And instead of one guy waiting, every man in the village is there to take us up this volcano. And like, and we're just swarmed by these people who are there. And they were just so happy and excited to see us. You know, we're like happy and excited to see them, you know, with all these Papua New Guineans. And they start like climbing up coconut trees for us. And like these guys will just hop on a coconut tree and just climb the tree, like all the way up there and start throwing down coconuts. They're like taking us up the volcano. And as we start to get up the volcano then, some of the guys start really freaking out.
It's rumbling a little bit. Just you hear these slight.
It starts to rumble, and then like all the 25 guys that are with us, they start like sprinting down the mountain because they're like scared of this thing, you know? Because it's like actually killing.
The guy's like, this road, die road here.
Yeah, this is the
death
road.
We're like, where are you going? Death, die here, road. No, be here. We go. We're like, no, we're good. Let's keep going.
Finally, we had to turn back because it was, I mean, it's a
smoke you couldn't see.
It's a steep climb. We were getting up into the thick of it. We didn't know if we were going to start dealing with like dangerous gases.
America, Papua New Guinea, America.
We love it. Right? People ride these sailboats around the world. They don't do anything. They don't stop and interact with the people. That's why these people just embraced us, because they didn't see us as tourists. They just saw us as some weird people that showed up in their island one day that were interested in them.
Bubbles. Bubbles.
And us being interested in them made them interested in us. And then, you know, the world opened up and we were...
And it's a real, genuine connection. This is something that's been around, you know, for hundreds of years. You know, they've outlawed women on boats at sea. They're bad luck.
I got you, Drew. I got you on video.
Seeing two ladies on bubbles.
There we go. Now you girls got it.
Right. Together.
Angel.
Together. Being a woman on a sailboat is interesting because sailing's kind of it's a man's world.
I think the sailing experience in any kind of long-term way, it's much better when matters of the heart are kept out of it.
Diego, you just stand there and just...
When you're at sea or on a boat, inherently there's tension. And then when you throw in a woman, there's just a different kind of connection between a man and a woman. Just changes the dynamic.
of your damned if you don't, damned if you do type thing. You got the girl, and she's good and everything, and you're having fun when it's good weather, but then you got everything else that goes with it. But then when the girl's not there, you want the girl, you know, but then, like, it's kind of nice that I have her. You know, it's like, it's just one of those things.
He always wants somebody around, a love interest of some sort. I mean, he's the captain, so the women just kind of gravitated towards him. You know, I'm thinking it's like this awkward situation, but he has a funny way of handling it when nothing's ever out of place and nobody seems to say a word.
Molly joined the boat. This was someone that I thought I could marry, and I thought, okay, no, this maybe this is a girl, you know?
I got the feeling that in the past, women were passed around, I guess. Girls become obsessed with him. People just love the idea of Alex. I've never met anyone like him.
I'm here, the equator into the northern hemisphere, and I as Neptune.
I mean, there are a lot of conflicting things within Alex. There's a really beautiful childlike quality about him and about the way he falls in love with the world. He has a willingness to open himself up and feel things very quickly, and he feels things very strongly. And to have that and then also have this drive to do amazing things in the world. Captain Alex is this character. It's very much a real part of him, but he's on display. He has to be a certain way for his crew. Some of my favorite moments were when Alex and I were on our shifts together. It was nice to get to know him more in that sense, more intimately. Alex behaves differently when it is just me and him.
About 2 degrees north of the equator on our way from Papua New Guinea to Palau. And this is pretty much what it's looked like for the past 3 days. Looks like it's gonna be like this for the next few days all the way till we get to Palau. I think we got about 450 miles left.
We're going through the doldrums basically. It took us 8 days, but it was one of the worst 8 day passes I had. And you might've heard the expression being stuck in the doldrums. It's when you're kind of down in the dumps or something's kind of holding you somewhere. And like, we were like literally stuck in the doldrums. We had no wind, we're on the boat, we're trying to like get across this. It's just like so hot, so hot. I mean, it's so hot you can't think.
In Papua New Guinea waters.
You start to deteriorate and go a little crazy out there. I mean, I remember at one point, I think this was on day 4 or 5, I was yelling at clouds.
Mostly just water. So we need more wind.
The clouds, they're freaking me out. They're like planning something against me.
Not a drop of wind.
I was like, I need to get back home. I need to do something productive. I was losing it out there.
It's a lot of downtime. Just sitting there, chugging along, and all you have is just a self-evaluation. Losing a parent like that, if that's something that's still bothering you inside, that's something you can think about a lot.
Gosh, it's hard to explain unless you know my dad or who he was.
We'll talk about your dad. Try and explain it to me.
Man.
Who was
he got one of those beers, Clay Camp? Is that a beer down there?
Sure do, buddy.
Yeah, thanks, man. I knew nothing else as a father than him, but he was, yeah, it's one of a kind. Just the way he did everything, yeah.
You think? Did you think about him when you were out there?
Ah.
There were times
where he would cry on the head of the boat. He always said that he felt like he was not meeting the expectations of what his dad would want him to be at.
Look at him. He's down to the boat. Where are you? Hey, you want to show mommy?
When you're growing up, and I think a lot of people have this, is, you know, you want to be like your dad, right? You want to do what your dad did, or you want to do something your dad does. And, you know, my dad was older when he had us, so he already had this, like, lifetime of stuff that he'd done. And I saw how people reacted to him and his accomplishments, what's still going today from things he did. And I was like, well, how can I even begin to do something as big as what my dad did?
From its beginning as a small regional grower in the 1950s, Rose Acre Farms has become the largest family-owned egg producer in the Rose Acre Farms, from the fastest-growing egg producer in the United States.
How can I possibly follow in his footsteps?
His father built this amazing, massive company, and I think he wants to do something along those same lines, but also change the world and help people. And he doesn't know how to start or how to do that.
Go.
There's a million sailors out here that want to, in theory, they're sailing around the world. But there's always something to fix. There's always something that's broke. There's always something going wrong with the boat, and they never get out, and it's like the easy excuse, you know? Russ got out, and he was just like, we're doing it. And that takes a lot.
Things broke all the time. You always break. That's a fact.
In the middle of the Andaman Sea, you can see we've got no wind. We've had a little trouble with the engine and stuff. We're trying to get to Thailand. Current's against us. At least the crew's still in good spirits.
If you're in the ocean, you have to be positive all the time, man. If you're negative, you're just gonna sink.
Over the course of the trip, probably spent close to another 100 on it. Bubbles, just different things that broke, you know, stays. We almost lost the mast in the Mozambique Channel. We had the engine out, two different times. Transmission we had out five different times. All kinds of weld jobs and, autopilot went through three of them and, nav gear, wind vane. You know, by the time you add it up, it can be pretty expensive. I mean, it didn't change the fact that what I was gonna do this trip, doing something that I love, you know?
Phuket, Thailand. He'd been trying to get me to come on and off for a while. Oh, I wanted to go bad, but I knew it'd be a bad decision. I wasn't probably ever gonna make it home and possibly die.
I wanted to see somebody from back home that I grew up with, I'd hung out with for a while, you know, being away for so long.
Happy New Year!
You know, you miss your buddies from back home, so it'd be good just to see a familiar face as well. You say hello too?
Say hello.
Alex needed some help on his boat, and his motor was junk, and he needed some parts. His refrigerator didn't work. I think the auto steer was broke. It's pretty much junk.
I mean, it's perfect timing to have him there. We had that thing out in 6 hours, I think.
Probably the dirtiest job ever in my life. It's covered in grease head to toe.
Woo! You did it.
We'd have parts laid out on the dock, and it's always rocking, shit would be rolling off in the water.
You kind of need those.
Important stuff. We sailed it, we got it running, I think the next morning, he knew we'd find some way somehow to get it moving again. Alex is one of a kind, unique, smart, dumb. I guess I could describe him as the smartest idiot I've ever met in my life.
Made it.
He was just away from home that whole time. Yeah, I missed him. Just be several times, be like, you know, Alex isn't here. It'd be nice to hang out with him or see him. You know, he's kind of half world away. I mean, followed along on Facebook a little bit, you know, see pictures, but it's not really the same thing, you know.
The first time, it was like this long, extended party, and it was just party from place to place, everywhere that we went, party with different people, and it was a lot of fun, but it really was just like a big, super long, extended party. And that was kind of like what everybody was into. The second time that I came on Bubbles, it was definitely more business, Alex.
Yeah, that was small.
You were like really concerned, and it was something that I hadn't really seen from you before. And obviously, over the months that I had missed of you sailing, you had become a sailor. And before, you were just a guy that owned a sailboat.
I feel like he was trying to like prove to everybody that like how hard he worked, instead of everybody looking at him as being just this crazy person that travels and does crazy things, that he was proving something deeper than that.
He realized that true satisfaction isn't with just partying. You know, the adventure, the exploring, the meeting people, and the beauty, that you know, the beauty that he's seen around the world, that's given him a kind of a new desire or a new direction or new perspective for what is fun, what is a party.
Jim was very fortunate enough to point out a storm coming in from the south, so we got the spinnaker down just in time, and Jim's now at the wheel trying to control the madness of this insurmountable amount of wind that's coming in. Now let's go outside to check it out.
Crossing the South Atlantic from Africa over to South America.
About to make landfall in St. Helena, in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean.
We're in a tributary of a tributary
of a tributary, of a tributary.
Off of a bigger stream, off of a bigger tributary, off of a bigger river, off of the biggest river in the world, the Amazon, and just kind of spending our day having to look around.
In the Amazon, constantly you come across these little communities going up tributaries, and that I think was the most interesting part of the trip, for sure. And for people who've never seen that before, I think it's also the most stirring, because it really makes you think about the way we live versus the way they live, and what you actually need to survive and what you actually need to be happy.
These people, they live richer lives than almost anybody I see in the rich world. I mean, they understand the earth way better than we do. The way they go about their daily lives, the way they wake up in the morning with the sun and go fishing, and then, you know, how they just sustain themselves. I mean, there's no technology, there's no media, there's no the advertising or business, all this junk that's just in your face so much here in the States. Like, there, it's just the world that's around them.
Shake one of the bigger ones.
It's tough sometimes when you get to a beautiful place and you start to get to know a lot of people, and you start to become involved with the community. It does get hard to say the goodbyes, but you know, that's something that we had to do time and again.
And how did you do it?
Usually with the flare gun, which we'd shoot like on the way out.
Do a little salute.
Yeah, that was we do the flare gun salute.
We're gonna count down from five. Ready? Okay. Five.
Okay.
Four.
You know, it's more than just the U.S. out there. There's more to the world than people worrying about taxes and the economy and minor family issues. I mean, there's people that have so much more and so much less to live for.
I decided, all right, we're gonna push to make it home before hurricane season this year. That's gonna be like, I knew it was gonna be in the May, June area, because that's when hurricane season starts. You know, I did start to get a little bit low towards that time period, because now when I'm sailing from port to port, I'm starting to recognize ports. Because before I got to Tortola, I'd sailed that whole chain down to Trinidad. So things are becoming familiar again, and there's one sense of excitement of getting back and finish it, but there's another sense of like, oh my gosh, this is almost over.
The boat's called Bubbles. If you ever watch a little kid, like I'm talking like 2-3-year-old kid, like if you ever blow bubbles and just watch the eyes of like a little kid just like grow and like kind of shine looking at this, but smile, the smile that comes across their face when they see like these bubbles just floating by, that's what this trip is to me. You know, me being a little kid again, just seeing the world and taking it all in as I go, and yeah, I mean, it's just like bubbles floating.
I sent an email out to all the crew that had crewed on Bubbles and just tried to get everybody that could come to come. I knew I wanted to do something special for the crew, some ceremonies, some passport stamping, some like awards and things like that. But I wasn't for sure what the turnout was gonna be either.
It was an emotional time to, you know, you've accomplished a huge goal. It's 3 years in the making, man, that he probably never thought he was gonna make.
Here's a kid from Southern Indiana that never had sailed before in his life. He jumped on a boat and he did it. Me and other people switched jobs in 3 years. People graduated from college. People had kids that were walking around in the 3 years that he was sailing.
That was the way we were brought up, was you don't finish a job until it's done. You do a good job of it. And so for him, that's what it was all about. It was pretty much a mirror image of some of the stuff that my dad did, take trips to places that people hardly ever go to and meet new people.
I think Dad would love it that Alex is, you know, going out and seeing the world and getting other people to get that experience as well. Open doors and see different cultures and lifestyles that they're not accustomed to. That's what Alex did in a big way for a lot of people, that he shared it with people. I think Dad would have been really excited about that.
What's the scoop?
It ended up being great. There was people flying in from all over the place.
I mean, that was amazing homecoming. Never seen like that ever before.
Great souls bring people together like this. Doesn't matter if it's spiritual leaders or politicians, but great people have this tendency, for sure.
Ceremonies that we had.
And we're gonna start with Teresa.
And it turned into these huge parties where we'd have, you know, 40 people crammed in the boat. People were stuffed inside and out watching these ceremonies. Alex was stamping their passport, giving them that memento, or that sign that they had successfully had a journey on bubbles. We are gathered here today to send off another great crew member.
I mean, that's how it was. It became a performance. And like people expected a certain amount of performance to it, you know, and we'd all take our shot of rum and we'd go through and just do this like ceremonial thing.
Everybody talks about the beginning of things, but tomorrow it's the end of one thing that's the beginning of another.
My memory, I see those, all those different ceremonies, and they started, you know, with the 30 to 40 people, and then they slowly dwindled to 10, to 6, to 5, to 4, and then boom. It was just Alex and I. I have that image of Alex writing on the one open spot. And it was just perfect, and he just wrote, "We did it. Dear Bubbles, we did it."
It was such a mixture of emotions then, you know, a joy that it happened and sorrow that it was over. Joe kept having to tell me, he was like, "I'm gonna take you home." It's like, now it's time to go home. And he kept having to like tell me this over and over again, because it's like, there was a part of me that didn't want to come home. I mean, I'm probably, I could honestly say I'm definitely the worst sailor to have ever sailed around the world, for sure, by far. Just going out to sea and just figuring it out as we went. I mean, there can't be the less experienced sailor or somebody that knows as little about sailing as I do and have done it. Like, there can't, and make it. Like, I don't know, it's you know, I thought, okay, yeah, it might take me a little time to get adjusted, you know, back into America after being out here. And seeing this and running on my own schedule for all this time, but then it's been way different and way harsher than I thought it would be. I went and traded again for 2 months in Chicago, and I was just miserable sitting in front of a computer screen, you know, doing the numbers thing. And I mean, after seeing almost every sunrise and sunset, and you know, sailing under the stars at night, and like meeting like tribal chiefs and having Amazonian mayors come aboard and like getting greeted by government officials and having people, the whole tribe will come and do a dance for you just because you're there. And I got addicted to it. And right now I'm going through like a crazy withdrawal.
He told me specifically, he's like, Reed, I thought I had it all figured out. I mean, it was so clear during those couple years, but now I'm more confused than I was before I left.
There's no freer feeling than leaving a port behind you and sailing over the horizon, to the horizon, knowing that you've never been to where you're going. You're leaving one port and you're going to the next port. You don't even know exactly where you're going, but you're just out there, and you know that what you're going to see, you've never seen before. And being out at sea on that voyage is, for me, that's the best drug you can have.
For 3 years, that was his identity. And he didn't lose it. He'll always be that person, but you know, he's not on a boat anymore. And to see him struggle with that is, it hurts me.
I'll find myself, I'll just sit down sometimes and I'll just like, it's like comatose. I just drift off and just, I mean, I can sit and stare at something for a long time and not even, it's pretty weird really. Maybe this trip was running from responsibility, you know, I don't know, or maybe it was trying to do something great, to do something equivalent that like something great that like my dad had done. Like I'm still trying to deal with what it means and what the deeper issue is.
Pieces of jaw, you can clearly see the tooth here.
The one thing that was like my dream come true, and then like I actually made it, and it's like, what do you do after that?
I think he has a deep-seated unease that causes his unrest. Time in a little bit more of a spiritual place could be good for him.
Hey, what's going on? It's Alex. I just wanted to connect with you guys. I know I've been kind of bouncing around and hard to get a hold of, and I might be going to India pretty soon, and so I also want to talk to you about that, to figure out what's going on with everything and whatnot. So also I have some more footage.
This is the home of the Dalai Lama in exile in North India. These are all prayer flags.
I think with Alex, he's always jumping to the big thing.
He had always wanted to go to India, and he had decided that that was going to be a good place to either clear his head or just do some traveling and to get away from the city.
One of the very last emails he wrote me was May 24th, 2013, from India.
Parvati Valley, North India.
It said, "Hey Vanessa, I'm in India. I just got out of the hospital. I had an episode of typhoid fever, and my temperature got up to 105 degrees. I'll be back in Chicago July. Hope to see you there." He wrote a lot of people on Friday, May 24th. And then nobody really heard from him on the 25th. So I have no idea what he did that weekend.
Mother Ganga ceremony.
You know, I had a feeling it was going to happen eventually, but to get the call is tough, for sure. He was in northern India, near Pakistan, and he caught typhoid fever. After he contracted typhoid fever, he was in the hospital for a few days being treated. He felt he was healthy, and he traveled to Varanasi, which is 800 miles away. He got a room at a guest house in Varanasi, and the next morning, they found him dead. From talking with the managers of the hotel, they said he looked like a perfectly normal person. They think that he died of the complications of typhoid fever.
Definitely, Alex was a daredevil. He had a daredevil devotion to conquer himself, to find himself. In the most purest of matter, he went 100% on what he did. Was it loving the children on the street? Was it reflecting of who am I? Why am I here? His greatness in his way of expressing himself in an existential way is something that that changes people's whole directions of life.
I wish he knew how much he has helped everyone that he encountered, and that he kind of already, I wish he could be content with what he did, because he did something great, and I wish that he could see that he already changed the world.
Words can never be enough to explain anybody. And to say that Alex, even less. I know I am still talking about about Alex and his trips and his remarkable example of what you can do with human life, where you can reach, and what are the true limits. Because we are limiting ourselves. Others can try, but it is us in the end who does it. And to meet persons, like I said earlier, such as Alex, who overcome this, is a fine example of human spirit.
Dude, that's good. Thank you.
a big family though in Indiana. 13 brothers and sisters? Yeah. That's a lot of family. Was it hard to stand out in a family like that?
We were on a road trip out in Iowa once, and we loaded up in the van to leave, and they did a head count, and they missed one of us, and it was me. and
what was it, like 5 minutes, 10 minutes, or?
About a day.
No,
come on. I was just kind of sitting there, so they called the police. The police picked me up, and they let me hang out in the patrol cars all night while they tried to track down my parents.
Are you serious?
Oh, I had fun with it. I kind of liked it.
Well, you're 15 questions away from $1 million. Are you ready to play?
Let's do it.
Audience, are you ready to play? Yeah! In 2005, what former presidential hopeful was elected chairman of the Democratic National Committee? Richard Gephardt?
Howard Dean! Isn't that him? Dean! Final answer.
Yes! You got it right there.
We're in the Bahamas. There's this island full of iguanas. Nobody lives on the island, deserted. Like, we're gonna get up in the morning, we're gonna kill an iguana and eat it. So we grill it up, and we have an iguana tasting party, invite people over, dip it in barbecue sauce, tastes like chicken, great.
The next day, we posted our pictures on Facebook. We went back to the boat, slept, and we got woken up at like 5 a.m.
Our boat was surrounded by Bahamian police officers, and we'd heard that locals do eat iguana meat, but what it turns out is that particular iguana happens to be endangered and only lives on that island. And there's no signs or anything. I mean, we didn't know.
And he said that we are arresting you for eating and killing an endangered species.
And they were like, we have reports that you're leading iguana hunting expeditions through the Bahamas. This thing just blew up, like real crazy, out of control.
We both spent about 2 days in the Bahamian jail.
All of a sudden, I got journalists contacting me. I'm getting hate mail from conservationists, environmentalists. And this is the same day that I posted the pictures. Like, this is how viral this thing went. It made the London Metro, the paper in Australia, TV news in Canada.
The way my parents found out about it is they read about it the next day in the Chicago Tribune. But we ended up going to court. We each paid a $1,000 fine as a penalty, and then we went on our merry way.
Colombia produces a lot of cocaine, right? And they need to get it over to their main market, the States and Europe. So one way they do this is they take it over to Venezuela and they put it on boats in this peninsula right over here. And this is one of the most dangerous places on earth to be in a boat. It is right here in Venezuela, between Trinidad and Tobago and Isla Margarita. So when we're in Trinidad and Tobago, there's this boat pulls into port. We'd heard the Navy is escorting them in, the Trinidad and Tobago Navy. And we talked to this guy, Dave, this British guy, and he has 26 bullet holes in his boat. So I talked to David because I was getting ready to sail exactly where he was coming from, because we're heading to Venezuela.
And everybody said that there would be like pirates, or you could come across a robbery or something. And we were like, that doesn't exist. Like, we're good people, we're never gonna do that.
And the wild sea monkey was slow, so what we did is we're like, okay, so we're gonna sail out of Trinidad and Tobago in the daylight, and then we're gonna wait right before we cross in the Venezuelan waters. We'll make sure it's dark, and then we'll just go as fast as we can at 4 knots, as fast as we can to try to get through this dangerous area, you know, and then hopefully by the time it's light, we'll be on the other side and we'll be good.
And about 5:30 in the morning, it was my shift. We find a small little vessel going extremely fast, off in the distance, coming right towards us.
I mean, I'm like, holy shit. Like, I'm freaking out. I'm like, who are all these guys? Like, we're in troubled waters. We don't have an EPIRB. We don't have a life raft. We don't have like any emergency equipment. We don't have a gun.
We're thinking we have to do something because we're not just gonna give ourselves up.
They came up to us and they circled us and they had guns.
So our first thought to do of what to do was we were gonna get absolutely naked.
When I popped out naked with the flare gun, I didn't point it at him, I just held it and I just showed him that I had the flare gun and that, like, you know, if I had to, I was gonna shoot it at them with their machine guns. I don't know, like, what they...
And I think it totally worked because they stopped in their tracks, and I think they didn't know what to do with us.
They left. They circled us once and left, but that was a very, very scary moment there, yeah. I mean, I fell off the boat once, actually, sailing from Panama to the Galapagos. we were kind of, you know, in the doldrums again, cross, right, just before crossing the equator, and there was just kind of a weird swell. And I was doing something up on deck with the boom, and the boom kind of rocked and came back and just knocked me right off the boat. But I was able to get back on pretty fast. And now another time when I about went that was really scary was in the Indian Ocean. And this time this is when we had no engine, almost everything was broke on the boat, but I was doing something with the jib, something was caught, and I was up there and we just hit a big wave and it just threw me like off the boat into the air, and I came down and my back landed on a stanchion that run along the outside of the boat. And it knocked the wind out of me, and I could have bounced either way, but luckily I bounced inside the boat. But if I would have bounced outside, even with those two people, and even in the middle of the day, I don't think they would have been able to get me in time. You know, you go through, anytime you go through a squall or a storm and people are on deck, and you know, it only takes one wave to kind of push the boat in a funny way that'll just kind of like throw you or jerk you. And even when Clay Camp was there in Thailand, Irish, I think, was sleeping on the bow or something, and we had just some wind picked up. And it just took the boat over, and I remember counting everybody, and I was like, fuck, we're missing one, you know? And then Irish was up hanging on to the lifeline. He was just hanging on to the lifelines on the front of the boat. So we almost lost him there, you know? So, I mean, there's definitely lots of close calls.
Christmas, and we were in Cape Town, South Africa, which I think was Christmas of 2011. Mom was like, Alex found some buried treasure, so he's buying us a trip to go down to see him in Cape Town. And Alex had found this orphanage, heard of it, and got a hold of him. And basically, they have a school, the kids live there and everything. They don't have anywhere else to turn to. They're just kind of out on the streets. But we did a visit actually there at the orphanage, and it was just a really good experience because the kids were, you know, they were showing us their rooms and their school and everything, and they were really excited to see people there. Alex had rented a van.
There's Mom on video.
And we went and picked him up and took him on the boat. Joe was dressed up as Santa the whole time, so like, you know, Father Christmas, Father Christmas, and they kept calling out to him. And then we handed out goodies, you know, and they just got to talk to Santa and got their gift and whatnot. That's what Alex did in a big way for a lot of people. They got to go out and sail, you know, and do stuff like that. And just, he shared it with people, wanting people to be able to go places and open doors and see different cultures and lifestyles that they're not accustomed to.